Hi, everybody. Welcome to Bigger Than My Podcast. And we are live, not live. We are pre-taped, coming to you from the outskirts of Dallas, Texas.
Plano.
Well, I didn't want to get specific.
People know us.
Well, now people are going to find us. Shit. So this is Jeff, your regular dude on the show.
Hostess man. With the mostest.
Yeah, man, I'm the dude, man. That's a horrible... That's a horrible Jeff Bridges impression. Yeah, man, I'm the dude. It's like Kermit the Frog.
Well, that sounds just like your opinion, man.
That's your opinion. Yeah.
The pig really ties the room together.
Oh, God. I am I'm Jeff Witty, Jeff W-I-D-D-Y on Twitter, and Jeffrey Michael Widman, a musician. I got some shit on iTunes and stuff. I'm joined by Jud.
Yo,
JD.
What's up, man?
And he is a regular on the pot Perkers.
Perkers.
And on soon to be another regular guest on another podcast.
Oh, shit.
Oh, shit.
Oh, shit.
Oh, shit.
Can't wait for that one,
We're really excited. Yeah, we're really excited for that one.
It's going to be awesome.
Super geeky and way more broad of a topic, I would say, than one man's discography.
Absolutely.
We're going to talk about Paradise Valley today. It's been a requested episode.
Yeah.
Which is cool. I appreciate all the comments still to date. I don't care if it's negative or positive.
Absolutely.
Any conversation
is good. Yeah. And this is actually the last full album that you have yet to cover on the podcast. So, right?
This is the last full album.
Not counting Inside Once Out, even though I still consider it one.
But. And this is probably the last in a lot of people's rankings, I would say.
Yeah.
even though this album is still, I consider this an easy listen. I can go back through this easily.
Yeah.
It's probably his shortest, one of his shortest.
Mm-hmm.
Not just that, but the songs aren't offensive. Like, they're not offensively bad.
No, it can really just kind of ride in the background. It's...
Yeah.
Yeah. I like it a lot.
And there's a lot of it, like... And we posted a... Not a poll. A poll probably next time. We should probably learn
Maybe.
To create one. I don't know how to do it in Facebook. I've never done it before. But we asked the John Mayer Knows Best Facebook group, which you guys should definitely join if you're listening. It's 4,000 proud.
Yeah. And very active.
Like, very active.
Incredibly active.
Yeah, especially during touring season.
Yeah. Yeah. I only think 900 people posted their ticket pictures on the group. So, but that's a good thing, though.
It's
I mean,
a good
I
thing.
Can totally
they're
share
hyped.
The excitement.
Yeah. They're like more hyped than I'm the one that started a podcast, and they're way more hyped than me
right.
about John
right.
Mayer than I
right.
am.
But you still posted your tickets, though. Like,
yeah, I did.
Yeah, I did. It's just fun, man. It's a good time.
But we asked everybody for their opinion on it. There's not really like a whole lot of history to go over in terms of the album because it just really follows.
Yeah.
He was writing it as he had still had vocal problems, so it was basically born and raised side B.
Yeah,
basically it was like Amnesiac to his kid A, more or less. In terms of if you want to talk Radiohead, I guess.
Yeah.
but before we get into it, I guess we got to talk about. We got to do the tradition, right?
I guess we got to do the tradition. I'm as usual unaware of the subject, but I'm fucking ready.
In your airiest John Mayer voice. Preferably singing because it's more funny.
Okay.
Answer the following question. I even type it out like this. Like, it's all formal. Like, I'm not the one asking the fucking question.
And then do you put, and JD goes.
And JD's all... That's how I write my script.
That shit out.
Favorite non-Mayer song.
Ooh.
That's a tough one, right?
Ooh.
Because most of my favorite songs are fucking Mayer
As
songs.
As John Mayer. Oh, god damn.
Ooh, yeah. If you could play it too, that'd be amazing. Right?
Well, I mean...
I'm trying to think of, this can be, do you want to like narrow it down to like recent or
I don't
earlier?
Know a whole lot of recent stuff, so I can go with like some Incubus shit I used to know back in the day.
Yeah.
That's actually still favorite, so.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
I got a lot of Incubus stuff. I know that song. Yeah, I'm trying to remember.
You could see me breathing, so why couldn't you have met me halfway.
That actually sounds like something you would play.
You only think about yourself.
Okay, I'm just trying to harmonize. I'm just trying to harmonize.
Trying to harmonize with an air octave above. It works out that the first word is breathing on that one, and you're going breathiest Mayer. That's good.
I think mine is.
That's good, man. I like that.
Shit, this is actually one of John Mayer's favorite songs, too. And I'm trying to remember how to play it. Yeah, that one. That's the one.
Okay. All right.
Look
looking out the door, I see the rain fall upon my funeral mother.
Oh shit.
Maybe I'm too down.
Alright, anyway, that's good. The talk about opposing voices.
Yeah.
Because Buckley is...
Right, well, and your natural voice is similar to Mr. Buckley, also of the same surname, so...
Oh, well, thank you. I would take that as a compliment. Some people find it a little too overwhelming, which I understand. I totally get it.
Dude, Hallelujah is, like, one of my favorite songs of all time.
Yeah.
So, like, there's...
That's a lot of people's favorite
there
song.
There is no way that voice or palette will, like, ever tire me out, because, it's...
That album from front to back, I think it's honestly still, I think, ranked my... Because, that's what I do. I make lists, if you can't tell by listening back.
Fucking John Cusack over here.
If you can't tell by... Yeah, I totally... let's not say anything. That's High Fidelity.
High Fidelity, yes. Also a favorite.
Yeah, that's a great... Oh, man, that's a great album. Or great movie.
I haven't seen it in a long time.
I make lists. If you haven't heard the previous episodes of the John Mayer podcast that we do,
it's what we do.
It's we rank and we list. There's one podcast episode where we ranked me and my buddy Kyle. We do another podcast. We ranked all of our top albums.
Yeah,
which was incredibly hard because we're talking of all time.
So you're talking all time cross genre everything. Okay,
and I think I would still put Jeff Buckley Grace up there as my number one, maybe.
Yeah.
Because it was lightning in a bottle against his own choice. Well, I mean, better judgment, I guess I should say. Because he's the one that chose to go swimming. And
ended up drowning.
Even though there was no drugs or alcohol in his system, apparently.
Dude, there's so much mystery surrounding that. Yeah, like, it's very morbid, but it's interesting. For sure.
But I love the is this the opener?
Dude, I don't know. I listen to that. It's on my favorites, so it's always spliced up. I haven't listened to it as a whole in a while. It's beautiful stuff.
I forgot how it goes. How does Grace go, everybody? Send me the tab in the comments.
Give us the feedback right now.
I'm just like wasting everybody's time. All right, that's great. He's trying to figure out a song. That's great. So that was the first segment. Now here's this segment. I'm like Pert Hadley from fucking Parks and Recreation. Now, another commercial.
Another commercial.
I took a quote, a Mayer quote for this episode. I just took it straight from Where the Light Is. And it's a paraphrase, more or less. Some people would tell you, this is during his rant, during Bold as Love. And again, this is a paraphrase because I was like, he kind of fucked up the line. But that's fine. We still love him. some of the people who would tell you they love you are the last to have your back. Mm. It's too real, man. It was so real when I heard it. Recently, it was just like, oh, it's so goddamn true. And I don't know if it has to do with maybe I have too many flaky friends or what.
I think it just happens with age, you know? People kind of go their own way a little bit. But yeah, it is a true statement, especially think about what it meant for him being in LA, playing that show and everything.
Like, right. And this was, no, he was with somebody. He was with somebody during the show. It was
Minka Kelly, right?
Yeah, Minka Kelly, yeah.
Yeah.
As we have discussed.
Right. Yeah, no, yeah, we did.
We dedicated an entire episode to her alone.
Seriously. well, and her and Leighton Meester. We did a did a cross comparison.
Right. Because they're the same person.
Same person.
And they did a movie where they're like the same person.
Yeah. Which is the weirdest.
that whole rant was great.
Yeah. No, that's a good quote.
I like that quote a lot. Maybe it's just a little too real. It's not necessarily one of those most profound quotes he's ever done.
No.
But I'm running around out of profound ones to choose. So
there are a lot, though.
It's just touching on how relatable this guy is, even when he's just not writing and singing songs.
Yeah.
That are most of which are incredibly personal to him and more so than to us. Sorry, dude, but we don't love who you love.
Who you love. Who you love. Dude, but you know what I like about him probably more than anything is that he's willing to take a step back and actually, like, joke about himself, like, on the roast battle. That was awesome.
Oh, my God, that was hilarious.
He took so much shit.
He did.
From that one guy in particular, and he got him good.
Yeah, he did.
That was amazing.
What song are you playing tonight? That was great.
It's like, John Mayer has many hits.
Yeah.
Jessica Simpson. Whatever the joke was, yeah, that was good.
He just stunned into silence. At least it was edited that way. But, Yeah, if you guys haven't seen Roast Battle, go watch that, because that shit is hilarious.
Yeah, that was funny.
I don't know if that'll be a lot of people's cup of tea, because it's so cruel.
It really is. Sometimes. But when you know that they're all friends and they love each other, yeah, and they go out of their friends. Way to say that, you don't really feel like...
Was that the episode where John rightfully voted for Olivia Grace over Todd Berry, and he was the only one to do it?
Yes. Absolutely, yeah, because they gave it to Todd Berry because he's Todd Berry.
Because I love you, Todd, and you're my friend.
Conspiracy here, did you notice on the following episode when it did the bracket that it had Todd Berry crossed off and Olivia Grace's name moved forward?
That was really bizarre.
Like, yeah.
Even though Todd's was funny. The one that was right there on the next bracket. Yeah. That was very bizarre.
Yeah, so I think she got screwed, and I think she could have won it. But
she is hilarious.
God, that was awesome.
She's so freaking funny, it hurts.
The guy who ended up winning, though, was just on fire the entire time. I mean, dude, he's just coming out swinging.
Yeah. Ugh. And he has more personality than the guy he beat. The guy he beat is, I mean, it's part of his shtick.
Right.
I'm sorry to go off on a roast battle tangent.
It's mayor-related.
But it is a little mayor-related. The finale, sorry for the finale spoilers, dude, if you haven't seen it. But when he went up against that Matt guy, who's a great writer... And I do enjoy his personality because he's very dry.
Yeah.
But the other guy seems like a dude you would have a beer with.
Yeah.
Just a regular dude.
Yeah.
Who just happens to be a good writer.
Yeah.
At jokes. And his delivery is just better.
Yeah.
He just puts more emotional and punch into it. Anyway, that's a great show.
I loved it.
We love stand-up comedy.
Glad you turned me on to it via Mayor because, I loved it. I even went back and watched the previous...
The season?
Last season? The last regionals leading up
to
the finals.
Those were great. Those were a little weaker, but...
Yeah.
Once you get up to the bigger names and the big rounds, you're like, oh, this is good.
Yeah, it was good.
Did you watch the season before it? I think it's all on Comedy Central.
No, I'll need to go back and watch
that
those.
One was like three or four episodes.
Okay, cool. Should be easy to catch up on.
Very funny. I think the winner guest judged one of the regionals or something like that.
Yeah, I saw that one. They brought him back as a judge.
Yeah.
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 Yep.
Lawrence, something Lawrence.
Yeah.
Bill Lawrence, the creator of Scrubs.
Totally.
Because he needs a win nowadays. He's not in syndication or anything. So I do have a lyric of the episode.
Okay. All right.
It's actually from
this
album, Paradise Valley.
Okay.
Which is a very honest album. You could say it's Honest Paradise Valley. You could say it's HPV. I worked so hard at that joke. I was like, how can I say HPV?
How long did that take you?
It took a long time.
Okay.
It took a very long time.
It was a good payoff. It was a good payoff. What is it?
It's from the last song.
Okay. Probably the best lyrical.
Yeah.
Song
there's
entry
a lot of there's a lot of movement going on in that
yep.
song lyrically.
Okay.
But life ain't short, but it sure is small. You get forever, but nobody at all.
Nobody at all. Yeah.
And then he sings it twice to make sure. Did you catch it?
Yeah.
Did you hear what I just said? Because you do have to think on it. Like, what the fuck does that mean? And then. I don't really think it's meant to be 100% gotten, like you 100% understand what he's talking about here. It's whatever it means to you.
Yeah.
But don't get me wrong, there is a meaning because somebody will likely comment and go, it means this. And I'll be like, oh, well, I'm an idiot.
But that's...
Life ain't short, but it sure is small. Shit, man.
Yeah. The whole song, even the you'll go back to love that's waiting, I'll unpack in a rented room. How's that life you swear you're hating? Like,
yeah.
Dude, oh my God, that's...
It's so good.
The whole thing.
The bridge is where he lets it all out, man.
Yeah.
It seems like.
Yeah.
But yeah, that lyric about you get forever but nobody at all.
Yeah. And the music where it's just get
the way it opposes
falling at all. It kind of slows it down a little bit. It's really good.
Yeah, the band kind of just drops back.
Yeah.
This is the only song that has that I can remember with harmonica, right? In this album, because he, instead of Born and Raised, was very harmonica-centric.
Yeah, and a lot of songs could have used it, now that you mention that.
Right.
Like, Waiting on the Day really could have used a good harmonica line in the background.
But instead he opted for that beautiful guitar solo.
Yeah. I'm not going to complain about Waiting on the Day. That ain't what I'm here for today.
That ain't what I'm here. You're not waiting on that day.
No.
Hey! Hey, I'm doing a shoulder dance. Hey! Sorry.
We have to describe it.
No, it's... We're never doing a video one, don't ask. Alright, so...
Yeah, we might. On the road.
On the road.
Hello.
We're gonna do a vlog.
Teaser.
A vlog.
Vlog. Waist up.
A V-L-O-G. Waist down.
Waist up.
No, but it'd be funny. Can you imagine a waist down vlog?
Waist down podcast. Oh, wow. That'd be awkward.
That would be very awkward.
Very awkward. I don't think my brother-in-law would let me borrow his video stabilizer. That was the plan. Oh, man. That'll be fun.
So I guess we gotta get to, because we can get just talk about each song.
Ritzy.
Actually, before we do that, I wanted to get to the Facebook
reactions
and stuff. Because we just basically asked, how does everybody feel about it? Because we didn't want to put out a poll that was like, do you like it? Yes, no.
Yeah.
We wanted more than that.
And the consensus was generally positive.
Yeah.
At least as far as what responses we got. And which, there's about five or six people interacting on it, which for a day, we'll take it.
So we got quite a few responses. A very active group, like we said. We did ask it kind of late. It was like yesterday.
Yeah.
If we left it over the weekend, it probably would have. Now we know.
Yeah.
We'll just ask over the weekend for the next one. So I think right off the bat, somebody left a comment. His name's Ethan, that said that he called it a gateway album.
I like that.
Which is the perfect way to describe
it.
And I think you were even telling me that.
Yeah.
That's how you felt about it.
Yeah. Well, seeing the next step, or at least part of the next step, has kind of put the puzzle together a little bit more. You can see some of the things he was trying to do, and yeah, absolutely. Outside of the negative stereotype of something being called a gateway. It's like, Mom, I listened to Paradise Valley. You won't believe what I did after that.
It's a gateway, like, search to everything, bro. Oh, my God.
Search for all kinds of
things. But like, the song Changing feels like a more refined, evolved version of what he was trying to attempt on Paradise Valley in general.
Yeah, for sure.
Just an example. So I like that. I like your opinion, which has to mean you're right.
Yeah.
And then we have this guy, Justin, who said that Badge and Gun and Who You Love are the only songs I don't care for at all. Wildfire featuring Frank Ocean kind of seems too filler, which is, it's a funny way to describe that because it's like a minute and a half.
Yeah.
I wouldn't say it fills much of anything.
No.
That's Paper Doll has its moments. I feel very strongly about Paper Doll.
I know you do.
I know.
I know you do. We'll get into that later.
But I love what I love.
Ding, ding, ding. Gloves are coming off.
Oh, man. This is going to ruin, as I advertise, this is going to ruin friendships.
This will seriously be the first time that we've ever, like, straight up disagreed on something. So, I'm excited.
Oh, man. But, yeah, I love Badge and Gun. And I think you mentioned that in your comment.
I do. Fresh
and somebody
on the
else
Badge and Gun train. But
great vocals, as somebody else mentioned.
Yeah.
Which is true. And you consider, like, that he was still going through, like, the vocal in repair.
Yeah. Literally.
That the effort that he put in there was a very strong one. I love that song.
Yeah.
A
it's
lot.
Great. It's great.
Who You Love is definitely one of the weaker songs on the album for me. I still find a lot good in the Wildfire interlude, poetically speaking, I guess.
Yes. I enjoy reading the lyrics more than I do listening to the song.
Yeah. Because it feels arbitrary.
Right. Absolutely.
And you're like, John didn't write any of this, did he?
when you told me what lyrics stood out to you, I was like, he fucking said that? Like, that's how little it actually sunk in. And I went back and read it, and I'm like, dude, that is actually a really, really solid line.
Yeah.
Like, I wish they had either done nothing with it or done more.
Right. And then Jane echoes my opinion. I think Wildfire and On the Way Home make up for any deficiencies otherwise. That's how I felt about the album on the first listen, completely. Yeah. Those songs speak to her soul. Amen. Preach it. and then it's funny. She mentioned that her husband hates John Mayer, loves Wildfire.
I thought that was great.
And you kind of did this thing where, like, you tied it back to his Grateful Dead inspiration for this and Born and Raised, which totally, I felt that now after you, I didn't, for whatever reason, I didn't connect the dots, even though it's clearly the last two albums that he did were inspired by the dead.
Right.
He sings about the fucking dead in the song. You would think I would recognize that, you know, it's Grateful Dead inspired, but it totally, I can see why that would be a more universal song.
Yeah.
Also, the song's just infectious as hell.
It
man.
Really
I love
is.
It.
Oh my God, dude. It great ending and a great beginning. And, the rest.
Yeah, the rest, yeah. It's on par with, to me, it's a stronger opener than Queen of California, but it's on par with that. It aims to set the tone.
Right.
Whether it does or not is a different argument, but it aims to set the tone and get you hyped for the rest of the album.
You and Ashley were talking about that one.
Yeah.
That'd be interesting for you and I to talk about Born and Raised, because I actually don't really like that song that much either.
Really?
Yeah. It's not.
You're not, because you're not looking for the song that Neil Young hung. That's the hardest line to sing.
That really is.
Neil Young hung. Looking for the song that Neil Young hung. All right, whatever.
It's not bad, it's just not my favorite, but anyway.
We have somebody who pretty much adored all of it.
That is true.
Her name is Jill. Adored Dear Marie. Found I Will Be Found. Right? To be amazing. Both Wildfires, she loved them. I feel like they're reprised Peter Gabriel coming singing. I don't even know what that reference is. Do I'm probably too in the dark on some musicians, to be honest with you.
Yeah.
Even though it's probably direct inspirations to John himself, right. You know.
I didn't know who J.J. Cale was. But Eric
Clapton. I didn't know anything about J.J. Cale until I heard The Breeze. And right before he released this album, Cale passed away. So it gave like new meaning to playing the song.
Okay.
The song is a crazy good groove on J.J. Cale.
Okay.
Himself.
To check that out.
Sounds very... Man, it's very more bluesy than... It's more folky on here and more bluesy.
Okay.
On the original.
Okay.
I don't even know what Coal Miner's... She name drops Coal Miner's daughter. Never seen it. I need to, though. I heard that's a big one to see for musicians.
No one till someone lets you down. So, yeah, I could see that being...
Yeah, the country influence is all over that. Yeah. And that one's the most tongue-in-cheek song he's ever done, probably.
Yeah.
Maybe since Only Heart, which was meant to be more like an ode to 80s rock, you know? not a country fan at all. Amen. Preaching the choir again. Badge and Gun sounds like Changing a bit.
Yeah. Which
there's a lot of this album. Yeah. It talks.
Yeah, dude. Fingerprints like just everywhere.
I am not done.
All right. Change.
Sorry, that's a great song. I remember there's some. Then we got Johnny giving us a great anecdote about Wildfire.
Yeah, I thought
Wildfire on repeat. Great imagery rolling through farmland.
I think that's cool. I mean, anything that you can tie back artistically to your family and an experience that everybody has, you know, that...
That's what the... Yeah. Not Journey. Boston. That's what Boston's first album was to me.
Yeah.
Okay. The one with literally all the hits on it.
Yeah.
We just played it on repeat all the way to Arkansas.
Yeah.
So that's... I totally get that.
That's cool.
The road trip experience. Any other time I went on a road trip, it's just stand-up comedy now. Preferably stuff I haven't listened to before, or else it's like, oh, I already know that joke. but yeah, he talks about... Johnny's got aspirations, man. He wants to do the Into the Wild thing and do what John did and go to Montana and for a simpler life. I like that idea a lot in theory, but I like too much current present-day shit for me to do that. I respect the idea of it, but for me, like... I'm sitting here looking at my phone on Facebook. I'm recording a podcast, you know.
What would you do?
Yeah, don't get me wrong. You can get a lot of inspiration from a songwriter perspective in those type of regions or whatever. Or any type of creator, really. But when it comes to, like, movies and TV shows and games, It's in my damn blood, man. I just can't get away from it.
I hear you. Hell, I think a week vacation sounds great, and I'm bored by fucking Tuesday.
Yeah.
Honest to God. Like... Even if I have...
That would be too.
Oh, man. So, yeah.
I go on vacation like in New York. I mean, New York City is crazy. It's a crazy busy city.
Yeah.
And I have to have something planned or else I'm just going to be bored out of my fucking mind in a hotel room.
Yep.
You know what I mean? and that's a busiest city in probably in the world. One of the busiest cities in the world.
Tokyo, maybe.
Tokyo.
The only other one that's like...
That's way too many people.
Hustle and bustle all the damn time.
All the time. Yeah. Rachie, I don't want to butcher your name, probably a nickname.
Rachie.
Loved Paradise Valley. Very different from his other work, very true. Not a fan of country, but the album grew on her up.
Great driving album.
Yeah.
That
seems to be a consensus here.
Yeah.
The album did grow on me too. It was one that I listened to and I had standout, like I said, I had standout songs like Wildfire and On the Way Home. Great opener and bookend. And then everything else in between it. I was like, God, do I like this or not?
Yeah.
I don't know, man. That was kind of like Love on the Weekend for me. It was kind of like, do I like this or not? What's going on with this? And I ended up liking it more than you did initially. It grew on me more.
I think we've come...
Yeah.
Come to a similar level.
I enjoy when it comes between the four songs.
Yeah.
I enjoy the placement of it.
Yeah.
And I don't skip it. I
still roll my window up. It's like...
Excuse me.
Then you can get your jam on when nobody can hear you singing it.
And Philip mentioned he... Hit us up on the one where we mention our podcast. But yeah, he said it was ranking lower on his Mayer LPs, and that's, I totally get that.
Yeah.
And then he has pretty much the same ranking system as we do.
Yeah, which is why I so graciously approved.
He was like, Battle Studies is his official favorite, and Continuum Heavier Things, Room for Squares, and Born and Raised are 1A, 1B, 1C, 1D.
Yeah, exactly.
So
we would have done that, but then there'd be no podcast, you know?
And then we would be There Is No Podcast, which is my other podcast.
Which is free!
Yeah, which was my other podcast. Do you want to make a podcast about The Matrix called There Is My Pod? There Is No Podcast. There you go.
We're just waiting on the name. Wait.
When my podcast is my own. Appreciate everybody's opinion on that, and we'll try to involve everybody more as I go through episodes and stuff. Through subject matters. The next episode will probably be an aim to talk to my friend James, who's also a songwriter. I think he already released an EP.
Oh, cool.
I'm so undereducated on his material, but he's great. He's a great songwriter.
Yeah.
And he wants to talk about Continuum. It's like one of his top three albums ever.
Everybody wants to talk about Continuum.
Oh, yeah, of course. we're going to try and hash that out, and I'll ask for more opinions on Continuum, because I know everybody loves it.
Right.
It's really just a matter of to what degree.
Right.
And what songs. What are the weakest? I'm going to ask more broader,
bigger
questions.
Yeah.
Because, we've already talked about Continuum before. Glanced at it, at least, on this podcast.
Yes.
Hopefully he's available, though. I haven't even touched base with him.
Get on, man. Not everybody has nothing to do like me, Jeff.
When my friend James is available.
All right, so we're going to go into the rankings of the songs, which is a good opportunity for us to just talk about each song as we rank it. I think our bottom songs are going to be very different.
Yeah, I changed it, actually.
Oh, you did? Oh, you didn't have to do that on my account.
It was not. Actually.
Oh, it wasn't.
No.
It was just with more...
But you might even hate what I did worse.
Oh, fuck!
Because, we'll get to it. Or do you want me to go ahead and start?
So here we go. My number 11 is... Not Paper Doll.
It's not
Paper Doll at all. It's the, what can I say? You hate what you hate, hate.
Okay. A reasonable... last song.
Yeah, it's a reasonable assessment.
It is a reasonable last song because it is...
It's probably his biggest regret.
Oh, man.
They did press together for this song, and Ashley informed me of this because I didn't... This isn't on his Wikipedia at all. This is like the least informed Wikipedia... His Wikipedia page has been about an album release. But I do remember when this song became like the third or fourth single, and he and Katy Perry did like played this out and about live. And they talked about how deep this song is. It's not that deep, dude.
No.
It's just not. Everything there is just explained. And it's just not. Especially when you start repeating yourself like that. I'm just not into it at all.
No.
I would love to say that, musically speaking, there's something there. But it's repetitive.
Yeah.
Very repetitive.
Yeah.
Very simple.
Yeah.
Which is normally I'm okay with. Like, I use simple to describe Slow Dancing in a Burning Room, but there's way more to that song.
Well, yeah, but that complexity is not on the musical level.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a little bit, but it's mostly just, I think the lyrics are...
Yeah, the lyrics hold it together.
Most people on that.
Yeah, but the lyrics to Who You Love is just kind of John's like, I'm a shitty person and she knows it.
Right.
And she's like, he's a shitty person and I know it.
Hey,
There's no redemption in this love at all. But, I mean, obviously it brings context to the title of Who You Love Is Who You Love.
Right.
I get that, but it's just...
I don't think it needed a song.
Don't need more Shadow Days songs, you know what I mean?
and after the fact, like, I don't know. I'm agreeing with you. It is not a good song.
Yeah. I like that Katie was... I was very concerned when I heard this was a duet that she was going to be all, firework! She was very, very...
She kept it down until the very end.
She was just going to Jeff Buckley the thing.
The tiger came out of the cage.
Yeah, tiger out of the cage, man. I don't know what happened.
Who are you love? Sorry.
Didn't fit for me at all. Katy Perry. Sorry. You went full Nick Cage and Katy Perry. Tiger got out of the Nick Cage. I like their harmonies a little bit. I'm trying to find positives about the song because it's still a song I never skip any of the songs. I'm a completionist. I never skip any songs.
I usually am.
I sing with it.
Yeah.
So I don't, even when we're talking least favorite Mayer song, it's still good.
Yeah.
In my opinion.
I know.
Like, it's still not the worst thing in the world.
I usually don't skip either.
God, I hope your last one isn't.
What do you
What's your last
like?
One?
No, hope to put it out there because it's typed out.
You already typed it.
Oh yeah, it's typed out.
I don't want to guess it. What is it?
It's because I just don't understand it. I didn't know the original. I don't really care for "Call Me the Breeze" at all.
Oh, that's lower on my rankings.
Yeah.
It's only because it's like you said,
it's a style thing.
Yeah,
I don't like the way his voice sounds in that song. Mm-hmm. And really, the music is fine.
Yeah, the music. Yeah, if anything, that song is fine.
Yeah,
that's the largest leap I can make. You know,
the way I ranked this album is not how I would have ranked a traditional Mayer album. Mm-hmm. I literally started clean slate one all the way through and said, did this song sound better than the one before?
Mm-hmm.
And that's how I ranked it. Mm-hmm. And I originally had something else a little bit lower, but I changed it because right now I just realized there's a little bit of substance there. This song does nothing for me right now.
Yeah, what's
maybe I need to hear the original to
maybe. I like the groove a lot in the original, yeah. And I felt like that was a little absent in this version. I like it. I mean, I like jamming out to it occasionally.
Yeah.
I really have to be in the mood for that song. But once again, though, I never skip any songs. So I guess that's on me. I can't complain.
Yeah.
Isn't there a line where he says I can't complain? Whatever. I was trying to sing it in his voice, but I couldn't find a melody for it.
Yeah.
I'm not complaining. Yeah, that's what it was.
Whiskey, whiskey, there you whiskey. Go. I'm not complaining.
So my number 10, this will not be popular because there is at least enough of a following for this song for disappointment, backlash. I Will Be Found, Lost at Sea does nothing for me.
Okay, I can totally see why you would put that there. You're not a birdie in a big old tree.
No.
Not at all.
And it's just everything so on the nose with this song.
Yeah.
It just doesn't, it's kind of like the song where like, dude, I really want to play piano. I should play this song. Hit record and see what comes out lyrically.
Yeah.
And that's what we got.
Yeah.
There's a lot more people that will connect to this song than me, and I get that. I mean, I'm obviously in the dark on Slow Dancing in the Burning Room, because literally everybody else loves that song. Yeah. But in terms of I Will Be Found, again, very, very simple.
Yep.
There's just not a lot of depth to it for me. I just can't latch on to anything in that song.
It falls into the middle of the road category for me.
Mm-hmm.
So, but I'm kind of with you. I mean,
you get it. Yeah,
I find pretty much anything outside of my top five in this album uninspiring. So, for me,
I get that. My top four. I would say four are the ones that I could on repeat listen to over and over again.
Yeah.
One of those four, I think you're about to mention.
Yeah, Paper Dolls.
Piece of shit.
Paper Doll is my number 10. And
JD is a fucking fuckface.
I know. When I told you that initially, I was so confident that you were going to agree with me. And then I saw your.
There are people that will.
I saw your little speech bubbles keep on going. I was like, oh fuck, he loves it. Because nobody writes that long when you agree with a favorite song.
I know.
And everyone's like, fuck yeah, I know. Like, it's very, you're getting it out there. It's visceral. But no, you couldn't believe it. And I tell you, man, I hated it before I even knew it was about Taylor Swift. And I hated it before I even knew that it was about, or that it was released as the first single. I just think that's just a bad choice for me. I don't want to get caught up in the Taylor Swift stuff.
Yeah, I mean, there's clearly a mention because she wrote that song 22.
Yeah,
a year John. Or two before that.
Dear John was the one that she wrote.
Yeah, but then she had that song 22, and then he mentions 22 in this song.
Yeah,
so that's why people were kind of like, maybe it's about Taylor Swift.
Yeah,
and then I had Ashley on the show. Go back and listen to her episodes because she's very insightful.
Right,
she has very many theories about Mayer and stuff, and one of them was that the fashion stuff that he sings about is actually from his time with Katy Perry.
Really?
Like, she talks about a black chiffon. Ashley says that.
So
black chiffon,
like,
Katy wears.
Specific outfits that she's wearing?
Yeah. She goes, Katy wore that at the Grammys this one time, and this, that, and the third. And I'm like, why would he write that in the same album he's doing a duet with?
Yeah.
Like, yeah. That seems kind of like a shitty thing to do.
Yeah.
And he's probably just telling her, don't worry, it's about Taylor.
Right. See, I wonder how much he's done that. Like, been with somebody writing something and had to be like, baby. No.
Babe, come on, babe.
It's your boy, John.
It's like Hot Rod. It's like, babe.
So, I have no other reason for it. I mean, lyrically, I'm sure it's fine. I didn't dive into the lyrics because they just kind of bored me. And
I get it.
I don't know, man.
I'm just kidding. I don't.
I know you don't get it. I know we're never going to come to understanding on this, but we're still going to be friends after this.
There's absolutely a simplistic nature. We're going to hear me say that a lot in this album to that song because it's just that.
Yeah. And I guess that's...
And the bass is probably bored as shit.
Very just, static.
I'm just going to play G the whole time, you know?
Ba-da-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba.
Man, this song leaves a lot... of room for harmonies in it, which is already something I appreciate.
Yeah.
More than the other songs on this album.
I do like that aspect to it.
Because I feel like when I'm listening to it in the car, I love trying to challenge myself with harmonies, finding the harmonies.
Yeah.
And I love doing like the third or fourth harmony in this song. Right. It's fun to find it. And it's gratifying too, because you're like, oh, it sounds like we're a fucking boy band or something.
You will really like Coheed. Try going for the seventh harmony.
Oh my god. What you
say? Yeah, exactly.
All right. sorry.
Had to get my Coheed plug in there.
I don't know any of their songs. I was just pretending I did. All right. That one's much higher for me, so I'm going to have more to say. Yeah. But my number nine was Call Me the Breeze. And,
All right.
It's more for the same reasons that you mentioned.
Yeah.
I can still kind of jam out to it a little bit.
Yeah.
Kind of. But it's not like in his pantheon of covers that he's included, that he's bothered to include on his albums.
Yeah.
Not the best.
No.
No, in my opinion. No. Sorry.
I prefer his live covers more to his studio covers.
It's probably one of the lower ones for sure. Like Message in a Bottle is fucking amazing.
Yep.
Freebird's amazing. I Don't Need No Doctor is incredible.
Free Fallin's okay.
Yeah, it's all right. And then, of course, you have Bold as Love, which is probably the best.
Yeah.
And then, of course, Wait Until Tomorrow, all the Hendrix stuff. It's like the pseudo-popular Hendrix stuff. Like a Hendrix-aholic would know those songs. I knew those songs before John Mayer played them.
Right.
But now it's like out in the mainstream, which is amazing because those songs are goddamn incredible.
They are.
They're so, Bold as Love is amazing. But yeah. If we're talking about those songs and then we put Call Me the Breeze in there, it's not the best thing in the world.
And one of the threads on the group was shitting on Crossroads as the worst song, right?
Oh, I forgot he put that as a cover. That's right.
What the fuck?
That song is a jam,
that
dude.
It's not anywhere near the worst song. I mean, you're entitled to your opinion, but sorry. No. That song just hits it so hard for me.
And then somebody posted, I'm trying to remember her name. She posts a lot in the group.
Yeah.
She posted the version of that live version that he did from Letterman.
Oh,
and he did an
intro
that's just fuzz guitar. And it's awesome. It is so cool. And Steve Jordan's in the back. Or was it Steve? It might have been somebody else. I'm sorry. I can't remember when he did it. If it was Battle Studies or if it was Paradise Valley. Because he did play Letterman again in Paradise Valley.
Okay.
That's how he promoted this album. Like, he played Wildfire. he played Wildfire.
Good choice, good choice.
On the show, and then afterwards, CBS or Letterman or whoever decided to do this did concerts, and he did like a full concert, like an hour.
Yeah,
and he played. I don't know if that was the one where he played Crossroads or not. I can't remember if he did it before. But I remember it was late as shit. I should have gone to bed.
Yeah,
and I was like, I'm gonna watch this.
Yeah.
I was so hyped. Oh man, because I wanted to see what his new band was like because it was. All new people. And,
yeah, true.
You know, like Steve Jordan wasn't there. Pino wasn't there. I was like, well, what's this sound going to be, you know?
So glad they're back. So glad they're back.
I know, me too. What's your number nine, man?
It's Who You Love.
Who You Love.
Who You Love.
Who You Love.
Who You Love. Yeah, I mean, I think we've already said more about the song than the song says about itself. And
my boy hurt the world.
I mean, Jesus Christ, it's so generic. It's not even a good love song. It's not even a good duet. And,
in my opinion, me neither.
And at first, I know I told you this before we started recording. I had it in my head.
There is a change in the song. The bridge. I forgot about that.
Yeah.
Where they add horns and they do a harmony. That's a cool part. There you go.
So you got eight measures of greatness. No, at first I thought maybe when I heard it on the radio that it would have been better if it had just been with somebody else and instead of Katy Perry, because I don't like their voices together.
Yeah.
I think she...
It is very strange. She had to restrain herself way more than
she... Oh, I think she went full blast. That was producers that pulled her back.
Yeah.
I mean, I'll bet how you heard her at the end was like the most mild she was. Like, really.
My understanding is that it was... I think Mayer said this himself in interviews when they were promoting the song for some reason. that it wasn't initially his idea. It was the producer, I think Don, what is it, Was? I don't know how to say his last name.
Yeah.
If it's Was or Was, whatever. He produced, co-produced
yeah.
the album with him, and he did Born and Raised with him.
Yeah.
He was like, what about Katie for this song? Because, you know, he up until that point, John just had This was his song.
That was on the fan docu, wasn't it?
I think it was, right?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. That's right. It was.
Absolutely. Because I'm like, I remember these exact words. I remember everything playing.
And he was like, oh, I don't know. Well, okay. You know, just kind of went with it. Sure. Because fuck it.
Yeah. Which, you know, to be fair, decent fallback.
Mm-hmm.
You know, things don't go to plan. You got Katy Perry in your back
pocket.
It just doesn't work. Doesn't
Not
work
100%
for
me at all. This was probably one of the weaker duets if we're comparing it to Taylor Swift.
Yeah, for real.
Because that song has a ton of redeeming qualities.
Oh yeah, for sure.
Half of them. I love that song. I love that song. I love playing it. I love the harmonies in it. Yeah. Love the lyrics. Who You Love? Yeah. Basic.
Shit.
So my number 8, I couldn't justify ranking this any higher, but at the same time, it's not as bad as everybody says. It's not the waste of space everybody says it is. And that's the Wildfire Interlude.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Is that higher for you?
Scotch? Just a scotch.
Is that a thing?
Just a scotch?
A scotch?
You've never heard the word scotch?
No. Yeah. I think you just made it up. And now you're trying to pass it off like
a word. That's a real thing. Alexa, Google scotch. Is that how you do it?
I don't have an Alexa anymore.
I know. it's a little bit higher.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, but no.
Yeah, but there's a lot of people. There are at least a group of people, and it's on the forum, My Stupid Mouth, and it's in the group
and
John
the group,
Mayer knows too, where they're just kind of like, why is it there? It doesn't make sense. And I get it. It's jarring because it's just Frank.
Yeah.
And there's no discernible guitar that I could hear. It sounded like John.
Mm-mm.
It was just kind of like piano.
Yeah.
And Frank, and some wildlife sounds.
Yeah.
And
a minute and 12 seconds
minute something
of it or whatever.
But yeah, there's very poetic.
Yes.
From front to back, I think.
I wonder if they were just chilling one day.
Yeah.
And
yeah, when they were when he was making he was contributing to Frank Ocean's album. Yeah.
So,
Channel
I mean,
Orange.
I get it, and I get the need to, you know, hook up your frames a little bit with that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. But it just kind of just didn't really hit me.
I get that.
Didn't really hit me.
I get that because it's just a minute and a half. How is it supposed to hit you?
Yeah.
But that lyric about on a vacation, you told me it was suicide. I can't hear his voice.
Yeah.
it's something about it being a shame if I'd lose you to the Eiffel. And I was like, what the fuck? That's way too powerful of a lyric for this minute and a half song.
Yeah. And is he driving
that
off
simmer.
Of a real situation?
Right.
Like, yeah, that needs exploration.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And it feels like completely unrelated to Wildfire.
Yeah.
Even though he sings about wildfire in it.
You could have called it a different name,
mm-hmm.
and it might have even fit a little bit better.
Because wildfire is about joy and...
Right. Especially what you
summer.
With
and this one's like suicidal, and I'm like, what the fuck?
At least Born and Raised and The Reprise had the thread together, you know, lyrically.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then a little bit of music, too. But yeah, this one just...
The lyrics are so good in that Reprise and Born and Raised, too.
Still a fan of the original?
Oh, yeah. No, I love it, but still I'm just surprised at how good the Reprise was.
Yeah. I agree.
When he talks about better learn how to turn the page. Half the time will be twice my age. Better learn how to turn the page.
Yeah.
I was like, what? This is a reprise. You're not supposed to throw fucking bombs in a reprise.
Bombs are falling everywhere.
It's Born and Raised Warfare. So that was my number 8. What was yours?
Yeah, I don't know if you're going to like this one or not. You're no one till someone lets you down.
I rank that a lot higher because it was just one of his more adventurous songs.
Yeah.
It's not in my top 4, though. Don't worry. It's not one of those.
Okay.
But I thought there was more value to that song than I initially felt to it.
Someone let you down.
Yeah.
I'm just like, well,
yes,
I must be someone now because you just let me down with this one. Don't get
Yes, I have hoyed. Got some who will boy.
It's not bad. Now we're getting into I can listen to these regularly territory.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I like the concept.
Yeah.
The title speaks for itself.
Yeah.
But I was like, wait, is that true? Wait. What?
Yeah.
It's one of those things where you read it and you're like, that's... Yeah. I mean, you don't really give yourself value until you've gone through some shit.
It's true.
And then you come out the other end stronger for
it.
So that's 100% true. And I love the... there's some lyrics in there, too, that I love. I don't have the lyrics in front of me. Sorry, I'm a bad host. But some of the lyrics in there are really great.
No, I've not seen you this way before.
Johnny Cash in it.
Standing in a mess at my door.
My door.
Well, it took you so long, but you finally found you know one. Someone let you down. Yeah, I can agree.
You believe that all people were strange and She'd never mess with your mind. I don't know. Whatever. Something about broken your crown. Whatever. The lyrics are good is my point. I can't remember all of them at all.
It's okay. You're usually perfect with lyrics and I'm terrible, so. And I'm looking at them right now and I still can't even find what you're trying to talk about.
Cause, busted your crown. You're no one till someone lets you down. That's a great... I like that song a lot. I didn't... Do you like it, though?
I like it, yeah. I absolutely like it. I'm into like it territory.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
That song is someone.
Just went to Aziz.
Because it lets you up a little bit.
Like it. Love it. Gotta have it.
Damn, that's so crazy.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. Sexy as hell. And then you gotta go into John Ralphio.
Oh, shit. Could do Aziz for days. But yes, we're in like it territory.
Okay,
sure,
good.
For sure.
Yeah, that's not that much higher, but it is higher.
Right.
So my number seven is, it sounds like you like this song more than me, but it's not a bad song by any stretch of the imagination.
Okay.
Waiting on the Day.
Yeah.
Is my number seven. Musically, this should be higher, but there's some lyrics in other songs that speak to me more. Because someone came and spoke for me. But yeah, waiting on the day, and you got to put the waiting on there or else it's just waiting on the world to change all over again.
Absolutely. Yes.
But musically speaking, this song is beautiful, and this song was much lower for me until I remembered the solo, and I was like, oh yeah, that fucking solo is just,
yeah,
there's so much emotion in that solo, dude.
Yeah.
It kills me every time he gets to that.
I love that song.
Like you could literally, it's one of those solos you hear it and you're like, I could put words to that.
Yeah.
Like, ow, it fucking hurts to be this way. Like, you just put fucking words to it in your head.
I feel what your fingers be doing with them fretboards, John.
But lyric, simplistic, it's very, very simplistic, basic lyrics to me.
It is. But it's very homey.
Yeah.
But it's not, though.
Yeah.
It's an illusion. I like digging deep into
it,
like, actually.
I can't wait to get there. Because if you give it more context, then I'll be like, I'll have to rethink my whole list.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
I feel... Yeah, that song has actually inspired me.
Long, yeah.
Like, in the
last, that's awesome,
2 weeks. So
that's incredible to hear.
It really is. So that's...
Will it be there for you, baby? Oh.
So.
Will it love you all the way? Will you love it all the way?
I will. I do.
I was like, oh, he's trying to rhyme something. That's what I thought when I heard some of those lyrics.
Yeah.
I was like, oh, he's just trying to rhyme.
Yeah.
That's all it is.
But will you take my side
in every little firefight? Yeah.
Oh, dude.
Oh, the Just a Kid line. You pointed that out to me the other day, and I was like,
Just a
Kiss. Shit.
Yeah.
That's going to kill me.
That was a good point.
Yeah, that was a good
one. That was a good one.
Just a list.
I can't believe what you did for Just a List. That was my response to him putting Paper Doll higher.
Just a list.
And it just happened to be playing in the background, and you used the word list, so it is mostly randomness, but...
That's a great line.
Yeah.
Shit, that's good.
Yeah.
And it's funny because you do yearn for that.
Yeah.
Even though he was 30 plus when he wrote this album or put it out.
Yeah.
You do yearn for that no matter what age you are.
Absolutely.
Like, you're like, oh, he's just young. He's just a young dude. And it's like, no, he's not. He fucked up. You know what I mean? And you're never going to get that. You're never going to get that.
I think it's cool that a song 3 years old can actually make you legitimately feel like how he felt in that song.
Yeah.
Even after being jaded for a little while.
So a lot of songs too. I'm learning that a lot of songs in this album are the same key. Like this one is, I'm pretty sure this one's just G or
same
D or something
gun.
Like that. But a lot of us, like I Will Be Found, is or whatever. And then you have I've Seen You This Way Before. A lot of the songs explore the same keys. Whatever, that's fine. That's whatever.
Yeah.
I'm not one to normally point that out. I'm just OCD. Like, I always put songs, whatever I construct an album, myself of my stuff, I'm always like, oh, that one's in the same key as the other one.
It's like a Scantron?
Because I don't want
to... Like you can't have too many C's in a row.
I have to abacadabra my own album, or else it's just not going to... It's not going to flow right at all.
Yeah.
I hate when I end my... Like, I end one song, and then another one comes in. And it's like the same key, so it feels like a continuation. And they're not meant to be. They're meant to be two separate thoughts.
Right.
So I'm like, all right, put a fucking capo on it. Let's.
Dude, I've seriously written, I have a song in my head right now. Mm-hmm. I've played it everywhere all the way up there. And I'm like, I'm settling right here.
Right.
I'm settling on the fourth fret.
I wrote
right
one that's
now.
Basically just.
Yeah.
What is it?
Drive.
How does Drive go?
It's this one. This one's
true. There we go. Oh, whatever the... I don't remember.
That's a go-to karaoke one for me.
Love I wrote something like that, and I was just like, you know what? Just put a capo on it. Just, yeah. Just a...
It totally changes it, dude.
It does.
Yeah.
And it's a different melody, too, of course. It's not just all Incubus.
And I would rip you to pieces for ripping off Drive, so I wouldn't even know it if you hadn't told me that.
That's funny, dude.
Anyway, that was a fun tangent for songwriters. Yes. So we're going to go into your number 7.
I have the Frank Ocean Wildfire there.
So, oh, okay, cool.
Yeah. Again, still, I can take some stuff from it. I just don't really see the need for it, but it's not an unpleasant song.
Mm-hmm.
So, and it has some redeeming qualities.
But yeah, it's just gorgeous.
Yeah,
like it does have, and it's on purpose, the campfire feel.
Yeah,
because you hear all of the just wildlife.
You hear like the embers just flickering away in the back.
Exactly, yeah. And he's just—it's literally you can picture Frank Ocean sitting there at a wild, campfire.
Yeah,
singing a song by himself or something like that.
Yeah.
On a vacation, you told me you were suicidal. Anyway, I can't do his voice. I don't think anybody can.
No.
But my number 6 was Dear Marie.
Okay, alright. We might be very, other than the waiting on the day, we might be pretty well lined up from here.
Oh, okay,
just
cool.
One behind you.
Oh, okay. Yeah. That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
But Dear Marie, though, has that lyric about, the lyrics really are what carry the song for me.
Yeah, until
not the
end.
Melody choices, per se, because they feel very familiar
in
terms of the blues.
And he keeps it pretty low register,
genre.
Too.
Yeah.
Until the end.
Until the Coldplay end.
Yeah.
That's what I call it.
No, you mentioned that in the
very
episode with Ashley, that
to
Fix You, right?
Yeah.
Is that what you said?
No, Face to Call Home is Fix You.
That, yes.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
But definitely this one has the sing-along quality that Coldplay is known for, you know what I mean?
Right.
Like they're, I'm trying to remember a song where they literally just do, like clocks.
Oh,
you are, it's a sing along. Dear Marie, though, has those lyrics that are incredibly relatable.
So good.
About the, being the boy you used to love when you were 15.
Yeah.
Which is too true. Now I wonder what you, well, I mean, obviously this isn't relatable at all, but I wonder what you think when you see me in a magazine.
Yeah.
That has to be a huge fucking weird thing for him.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, think about what that would mean. Like,
yeah.
It's like Scott Pilgrim, I guess.
Yeah.
Like, you know, like the Clash of Demon Head.
And then you have the lyric about looking for Marie and looking for your photograph online.
But
all I could find was
Ohio County Judge. Yeah.
That's genius, dude.
Yeah.
I don't care
cool.
if you're trying to rhyme anything.
Yeah.
It's just.
So is
that
he,
is so true. That's
is
I'm not
saying,
trying to say admit to being a stalker. But
yeah,
that's happened before.
No, yeah, I'm with
you.
I've got there's a couple.
Like, what does that one girl you used to look like?
Yeah, there's a couple, but I mean, yeah, not any I'm going to mention. Not even going to talk about. I think that's hysterical, man. Because who can't relate to that?
Yeah, I know.
Who can't relate to that?
It's a good little ditty too. This is the one time I'll use the word ditty to describe one of John Mayer's songs.
I think a lot of people like it overall.
Yeah.
I think that's actually
think so
a lot of people's top 4 or 5.
Yeah.
So
and then you have that part at the end, the super catchy part at the end that I'm sure the live crowd really loves. And it sounds big too when he plays it with a band because you have he has backup singers and they're all just they're all just singing it and it's just got a very big sound.
I like it.
I like it lyrically, though. What's your number? Are we on?
I'm on my number 6.
You're 6.
And that's where I've got I Will Be Found. Parentheses. Lost
you will be found.
So I originally had it ranked a little higher on my first listen through. And not like that was my first listen through ever, but clean slate listen through. Like, tried to wipe my brain of opinions. And it just kind of slowly crept down. I don't like the birdie in a big old tree.
Yeah, I don't really like that line.
It makes it too silly for me.
Yeah, it does.
And so,
except there is a part
really
in Badge and Gun where he says big old empty arms, and I'm like, that works. But big old tree, I'm like, you lose me, man.
Yeah. It's the birdie in a big old tree.
Yeah.
that really is why it's so middle of the road for me.
Right. I did already mention that one. I was like, did I have anything to add on that one? Nope, I'm pretty sure I already.
Yeah.
It's just kind of forgettable for me. I mean, the only thing that was really noteworthy on it was it was like the first piano driven one. And I'm pretty sure that he
took that into
pretty much played all that.
Yeah.
Not that he hasn't before, but this was like his first exploration into, you know, the you're gonna live forever in me territory.
Yeah.
Did you see that little video that somebody posted with him at the piano?
Yeah.
Dude, that was cool.
Yeah, that was really cool.
Yeah.
Fucking show off, piece of shit.
I know, right?
No, I'm kidding.
It's like, what do you not know how to play, John?
Can you suck at one thing for 2 seconds?
Seriously.
Seriously. Do I have to get Playboy in there to interview you again so I could feel better about myself? Then we have my number 5, which is "You're No One Till Someone Lets You Down."
Okay.
I mentioned that it has a lot of lyrical value in it.
Yeah.
It's one of his most clever songs, I think, because of how I mentioned that it's so it's tongue-in-cheek. It's almost like a comedy song a little bit, but at the mm-hmm. same time, there is a message there.
Yeah.
And it's short and sweet.
Yeah, it's pretty quick, right?
Hit him, get it, come in, hit him, and hit him hard, and then leave.
You get in, you get done, and then you get going.
It's Assassin, right?
Yeah, it is.
Get in, you get done, and then I get done. I'm pretty sure that's how the guitar part goes. It's like,
don't forget to get a towel. That couldn't be more right.
I'm working the dead of night. Where the roads are quiet. No. It's like John Mayer shreds up in here.
Wow. Where do we go from there?
I don't know. What's your number 5?
Dear Marie. So we just went over that one. It's on the fringe of what I consider to be my favorites on the album. So mm-hmm. I like the end. I like the build up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a great build up.
Yeah, and you know, like you said, it's got some inspiring lyrics in there, relevant ones, and none of my favorite lyrics come from that song. But overall, you know, feels a solid middle of the road.
Yeah.
Then we get into the goods.
Oh, we're getting to the good shit.
Into the goods.
Because my number 4 is one of the best songs ever written. It's Paper Doll. Okay, it's not one of the best songs I've written, but I think this is a really fucking solid song, and okay. I like the use of fashion as imagery.
Yeah,
because I don't know anything that he's talking about, but I like the ending lyrics about if your angel wings don't fly, someone's just gonna paint you another sky.
Yeah,
it's pretty much saying, you know, any I mean, I'm expendable because any guy's gonna come in after me and.
Right.
And pretty much give you anything you ask for, but you're not going to learn anything that way, and whatever.
Yeah.
I know that I added way more context to those lyrics, but... But still. But I love the harmonies and the chorus a ton. I like the lyrics in the chorus, too. Are they just not your favorite lyrics in the chorus?
Honestly, it starts with the music. I can't really jive with it. It just does. It's not something I would really ever listen to style-wise. And then the lyrics. I think at first, before I knew it was a potential shot at Taylor and a single and all that, I just was kind of like, is he just like playing with paper dolls? Might have taken it a little too literally.
Maybe.
And yeah. Maybe that's what turned me away from it. And then once I uncovered that what's beneath the surface is actually about Taylor Swift, I'm just like, yeah. I'm not gonna say I'm not being unreasonable about it.
Yeah.
I just don't like it.
It's just funny how it's all about this artificial woman or whoever that he's dating.
Yeah.
That isn't, for some reason, he's
that can be whatever he wants her to be at that moment in time or I
don't know. And he's just like frustrated that she won't settle for him. Like, it's just crazy.
Yeah.
Like, you're into all this superficial shit, but you can't. Was it just too far to fall? I mean, yeah. Shit, man. I mean, I'm right here.
Yeah.
Whatever. Anyway, what's your number 4?
My numero cuatro is Badge and Gun.
All right.
Sheriff Coral, get your badge and gun. Give me my badge and gun.
Welcome to Pee Pants Town.
Yeah.
Back me back, keep skirt nights and skirt-a-der. It's a great song.
Yeah, it's just really chill. And when you can, I think like one of the commenters said on the post, once you can get past like the literal, like, hey, I'm a cowboy John, I got my badge, I got my gun. Hey,
mm-hmm.
Once you get past that and you realize that it's actually more just about working through some shit.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, my favorite lyric from the entire album is out of this song.
Really?
It's the lock is on the cellar door. I can't remember what it's for. I haven't been down those stairs in oh so long. So what can he not remember is therefore the lock on the door or what's behind the door?
Yeah.
So that's kind of where I'm like, all right, so whatever about himself that he's locking up in there is something that he has obviously not visited in a while. So I view it as kind of like, I don't like the music. It's his progression forward.
Yeah. Shit, that's deep. I didn't even consider that. I was just like, oh, it's just about life on the road. Like, he hasn't been home in a long time.
Yeah.
Or whatever.
But maybe that's what
Which is one way to look at it.
For is that sense of home.
Yeah.
And maybe he doesn't have it up there like he thought he would. So, yeah. I mean,
that's my number three, too. So, I mean, I might as
well. So, we're not too far off. Yeah.
No, not at all.
Not at all.
Our one and two might be interchangeable. Who knows? I don't know how you feel, how strongly you feel about one or the other. We could have a battle study situation in our hand. Where I'm like, your number one's the same as mine. No, it's not.
I think we agree on number one.
Okay, good.
Yeah.
Maybe not. Maybe not, though.
Okay.
We'll see. I don't know.
We'll see. Are you pulling the JD on me, Jeff?
My number one is 83. Oh, wait, wrong list. My best song from Paradise Valley was 83.
Okay.
Because 83 is better than most of the songs on this album.
We'll take it. Absolutely. Without question.
Especially the one part where he just plays this over and over again.
Yeah.
I'm not done yet. Five more minutes of this.
Yeah, well. At a minimum.
Sorry. Okay. That's ridiculous. Keep going with it. Yeah, Badge and Gun, for whatever reason, this song reminds me of youth, even though it's more about shielding yourself from things.
Yeah. Or growth.
Or growth. Trying to prepare yourself for certain things that you think are going to be hard in life.
Yeah.
Confronting things from your past or
potential
to your future.
Yeah.
But I've always, like, associated, like youth and growing in general.
Yeah. And growing
pains. Yeah, there's more to the song than just... I'm like the like Jeff Bridges from True Grit now,
cowboy now.
Yeah,
I feed my horses all the time.
Yeah, give me down the golden hair.
Yeah, I think the I'll use the word ditty there. That little ditty after the verses is what hooked me. That little progression, that's what hooked me musically, and then I started digging deeper into the lyrics, and it's good stuff, man.
Great. I wish I could remember more lyrics. I wish I had them in my head. But my number two was...
Hold on, we're on number three.
Number three, sorry.
Or your number three was Badge and Gun.
That's right. You're number three then.
So mine is On the Way Home.
Oh, shit! All right, that's my number two.
Okay.
God damn it. I'm waiting on the day. That's right. I forget. Yeah. I forget that you love that song. All
right. But we both agree that On the Way Home has the best lyrics, A to Z, on the entire album here. Freaking awesome stuff.
Summer's over, this town is closing. They're waving people out of the ocean.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I love the I love the storytelling in this song so much.
Awesome.
So much. We never noticed where time was going. Because it's true, when you're having a good time, you're like, oh shit, we gotta go home now? Fuck.
Yeah.
The chorus is fine. On the way home. Yeah. Which is true. You never have to feel alone. Yeah. Just whatever. Anyway, the lyrics.
Like the
I mentioned the little bridge there where the band just kind of quietly ever so present quietly, and he's just kind of a laughing shirt, but a shirt is small. You get forever, but nobody at all. And it don't come often, and it don't stay long. Jesus, that's a knife to the heart, man.
Because
it's just truth. And all.
Stay on the run, get off the grid, and hide yourself out like you know the night.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. That really, it's basically a summary of everything you've just heard.
Yeah.
Like,
honestly, this could be.
It probably was the
first
song.
If he never released a song again, like, never released an album again, this is like the perfect summary of everything he's ever done.
Yeah.
In my opinion.
Yeah, but God,
I mean, except for Real.
It's a scary thought to go
ahead. I know. I know it is. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Please release all your waves.
Stop being so mean.
Please release all your waves of your songs. But yeah, On the Way Home is one of those things where, like, I guess he's done. Is he folding up shop? What's going on?
Yeah. No, you could definitely take it to mean that way, and especially after 3 years without music, I could definitely see how somebody revisiting this would be like, well, shit.
Yeah, I guess he's done.
When's it gonna happen?
So, yeah, no, that's a great song, man. Fucking phenomenal song. What's your number two, then?
I've got Waiting on the Day.
Oh,
Waiting on the Day.
Yeah.
We all misunderstood. Had to grab your badge and gun and mix lyrics like you should.
Anyway.
Did it just for this. Wow, I butchered that. So much for learning it in a day. No, but God, dude, I love it.
Well, you can't forget. Working the dead of night.
waiting for so long.
We're gonna title this one Guitar Butchering. It's because of the whiskey, folks. It's because of the whiskey.
Whiskey.
No, it's my number two. I think I could have even made it my number one and not felt bad about it, but mm-hmm. Wildfire is just so fucking.
Yeah, Wildfire is amazing.
I just, this song hit me, and I don't know, it's just got that sense of longing, that sense of hopefulness,
mm-hmm.
but it's still very, you know, I don't think it's based on anything tangible for him at the moment, so mm-hmm. he's still got to go out and get it. He's got to go out and search for it. But yeah, I like it. When this house is my home and plans are made, and I love the little chorus, man. I love the melody there.
When you be there for me, baby. You love me all the way.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a great.
And then the firefight line.
Such a beautiful.
Yeah.
So beautiful song.
I could listen to this song on repeat. All day, every day, and never get bored with mm-hmm. it.
So you can tell he put everything he had into that Just a Kid line because the band really comes in. Like there's a rise and fall to the song, and that's where the band is like the most quiet. And like when he hits the Just a Kid line, everything fucking comes back in. You can tell he had a lot riding on that line.
Yeah,
I like it. Very relatable for him.
Yep.
But yeah, Wildfire is
it's a consensus number one.
God damn it. That song is incredible, dude.
Yeah. It's so good. Like, I literally want to go, like, walk around my neighborhood and be like, hey, hey, hey. Like, start grabbing people in and shit.
That's the kind of music video you imagine for this.
It just catches on so quickly. Like, if you don't like this song, I question your judgment at this point.
Yeah, I know, right?
Really, it really, really is at that point.
Not just that. There's great, I mean, aside the bridge lyrics, which are, like, nonsense. They're just meant for storytelling, I guess, to set a mood.
Yeah.
Unless somebody's going to correct me, please, by all means, throw me a definition of what the hell the bridge is about with the medicine bag and all that shit. I don't know what that is.
I think he literally just took a rock from a river and put it in his medicine bag.
Yeah, and he's just kind of like, hey, I went on an adventure. Maybe that's what it is.
River in the medicine bag. And I'm like, are you Dr.
He's
Quinn?
Just basically like, I'm just collecting things from my time in nature to say that I did it, you know, instead of taking a 3x5 at the moment.
I might... Okay, a rock in a river is being shaped by that river due to erosion, which
science
still exists. So he grabbed it, put it in his medicine bag, you know, with other things that are like nurturing. So maybe it's like symbolic. I don't know. I'm going on the total.
Could be. And that I think
aliens.
That's the way he designed the aliens.
Aliens.
That's the way he designed the song is to keep us guessing and make our own definitions of it, I guess.
But it's probably outside just of that shit. And he found a rock.
Yeah, he's just like, hey, I found a rock in my river. I got lyrics for the bridge.
I don't have anybody to tell this to, so I'm gonna put it in a song. Katie, look at that.
Feather in the mirror's in her bag.
She's like, well, you love what hobbies you love, and then like, single.
Say, a bit some kind of day.
Are we going to Randy Newman everything it is from now on?
I can't play that fucking song. I've yet to...
Live as strong you can. Swim inside it.
Yeah, that's way too ambitious on guitar
for kills. Me. Yeah, he does kill it live, though. He fucking just solos the shit out of it.
Do you think he'll have room for it?
And then he goes... You're
working the dead and
stop going back to the shitty version of Assassin.
Assassinating Assassin.
Yeah. Shitty Assassin. That's what we're going to call it. Whenever we can't play a song and we just butcher it, we're just going to call it shitty whatever.
Yeah, there you go. Applicable.
No such thing.
Yeah, that's totally it.
Sounds just like it.
I want to run through the halls of this G chord. Apple Bonbons. Hey, shout out to Quincy from the very, well, I mean, from life, because we know him, but like from the first episode, we just remayored the shit out of Assassin.
Yeah.
We just did that.
Yeah, he wanted to, his
idea
was
going to be a segment, right?
Yeah.
To remayor things.
Yeah, I mean,
we
to remix it.
We should absolutely do that. Officially.
I almost, I was in the middle of writing, moving on, getting over about pooping.
well, yeah, hold on. No,
I won't do it, though.
Come
I...
on. No, come on. Come on. Because it started with me literally not being able to find my keys. And I said
hold on, I can do the...
I said, no problem. I'm gearing up and heading over. And then I was like, I just said that in the likeness of moving on and getting over. But I just can't seem to find my keys. Dun, dun. And then you fucking took it to another level. And that was brilliant.
Tell me I can keep my butt crack open to let poop through. And then it's
from a walking,
I can't understand.
Oh my god.
Brown stains keep coming back again.
You're one roll away from being out again. Like you're
almost
out
terrible.
Of toilet paper.
This is the worst.
You're pooping on.
We're 5 years old, making poop jokes. How am I going to leave this in the episode? I'm going to try it and see how people feel, because this is the real us. We make
it really
jokes.
Is. Yeah, fuck it.
But yeah, Wildfire is really great.
It really is. I know that's a ridiculous song. That should be the one song we didn't tangent on, but...
Yeah, I love the lyrics in that song are really paint a good picture for us.
Tonight the moon's so bright, you can drive with your headlights out.
Yeah, that's great.
I'm not so big a fan of the put your feet up next to mine. Get your nasty feet away from me.
Yeah, I know.
That's fucking stupid.
I love the melody. Oh my god, the melody. I'm not a feet fan either, but the melody.
Yeah.
Of the you can dance with the dead, you can rest
your head
on my shoulder if you want to get older with me. I imagine that being like a moment when he's writing the song.
Yeah.
When he's writing the lyrics, he's like, ah, fucking nailed it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? That's one of those moments, man, in the song that just totally blends together really fucking good melodically and harmonically and everything. Oh my god, it's so good.
Yeah.
I love the chorus, man, because it's not just saying words for the sake of melody.
Right.
Which some of these songs offer that. They make sense together. Like the say, ain't it been some kind of day you and me been catching on
wildfire.
That's, I guess, near the end.
Yeah.
Whatever. But you and me been catching on like wildfire. It all makes sense. It sets a mood. I can envision it. It's a scenario I can actually picture in my head.
Yeah.
Even the feet up next to mine. I don't like nasty. I don't like feet. Feet are nasty.
They're not attractive.
Feet. Nasty feet. All right, so I'm sorry. He might take me off the air if he hears I'm doing an impression of him.
Yeah. Wrong.
You're just a magpie feather.
What's
his
name?
There.
I'll ruin his career. I'll just ruin it. magpie feather. Yeah, all I am is a magpie feather in a podcasting bag. That's all I am right now.
Ain't it been some kind of day?
Ain't it been some kind of podcast? So that's pretty much what I had to say on Wildfire.
Yeah.
Fire Wild.
I think we agree on it, man. It's the best of the bunch. Barely. I think you could make a case for I think any of our top four songs.
Yeah.
Really could be made a case for the best song at any given
Apparently
point
Paper
time.
Doll is a 50-50 song for a lot of people.
Yeah.
I pointed it out in the status that we read.
Yeah.
A lot of people just weren't.
And it's okay.
Huge on that song.
I don't hate you.
They weren't huge on it.
I don't hate you for it. I don't hate you for it.
We're just never doing this again.
Yeah, probably not.
Not together. I mean, you can do your own thing.
Yeah, I mean.
You can call it something else. Like your body's
22 assholes.
Your body's a podcast or something like that.
I can rip off the one that we tried to do, Fat Guys in a Little Podcast. Just one fat guy in a little podcast. But like it'll be really weird because it's going to taper off after the word little. Like the tagline will go. And so everybody's going to be like, what is that? But yeah, overall, man, I mean, I'm glad we got to do the album. Otherwise, I probably wouldn't have dug as deep into it at this stage.
Yeah.
Because there's a lot under the surface.
I'm glad I pushed somebody to do it because I think that was the only way to get somebody to do this album with me is to push them to do it.
Yeah.
Because I don't think anybody listens to this.
You didn't have to convince too hard.
Anybody that I know, at least, listens to this as frequently as they do his other stuff.
Everybody in our lives that are Mayer fans, we're like, room for squares or bust.
Room for squares or bust, continuum. Yeah. Or continuum.
Or heavier things.
Continuum continuum and pre-continuum or bust, yeah. Basically. Yeah. Yeah. Or where the light is, too. Let's throw that in there.
Yeah, okay. Okay. I haven't listened to the last episode of Quincy yet. I'm going to do that tonight. But has he listened to anything past continuum yet? Have you gotten him to do that?
I don't think so.
Dude, we gotta push him. We gotta push him to do that. I think he would like a lot of stuff on Born and Raised.
Because every time I'm like, oh, Quincy's going to like this, he's always like, nah, man, that was shit. That was balls or whatever. And then he's like, hey, but that one song from whatever band, I'm trying to think of a band that I'm not that huge of a fan of and he's like big into, but yeah. I can't think of one off the top of my head.
Okay.
I can't think of one. I'm sorry.
Drawing a blank, too.
Because normally I listen to the same shit he does. Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, I think with this stuff, too, it's interesting to get a somewhat fresh perspective. Because I wrote this album off when it first came out.
Yeah.
Totally. I wanted nothing to do with it. I'm like, this is not... I mean, I liked Wildfire.
Yeah, it's a great opener.
I mean, I heard that one, but everything else at that time in my life just didn't really hit with me. But this is an album that once you've gone through some shit,
yeah,
you can definitely relate. Same with Born and Raised.
Yeah. So. Oh, my God, especially Born and Raised.
God.
Every song, one after another, is a gut punch.
I might end up, if I listen to Born and Raised a little bit more, I might end up putting that above Battle Studies on my ranking. I really might. I think you already did.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I can't remember how to play it now.
It's so good. Every time I listen to both of these albums, I find something else to appreciate in them. So at least it still has that aspect for me.
I learned how to play Age of Worry, and now I forget how to play it. Assassin time.
I work in the dead of night, butchering songs, finger in my
fretboard. In what context would people play that fucking chord? Unless you're playing
Dave
Neon.
Dave Matthews would rock that shit out.
Unless you're playing Neon. Anyway, that's this episode. We kind of went off on in a dark hole of randomness at the end of it.
It's okay.
I guess we can end it on the mayor song of the episode.
Oh, yes.
Like, shuffle and we see what comes up. It's probably going to be a song that we've already fucking done, but...
Never fails.
Yeah, never fails.
All right, let's see. All right, let's see what we're going to do.
Dude, radio voice. All right, so it's... Oh, wait, that's La La Land. I'm sorry.
Get your Gosling out of here, man.
I fucking love that movie.
Yeah.
All right, sorry.
Ryan Gosling is the paper doll of real life. No, you know I'm joking about that. I'm just trying to trigger you, bro.
I'm Ryan Gosling. Hey, I can't even.
I know this is a meme from like 5 years ago, and we can all agree Ryan Gosling.
Oh, hey,
is
girl.
Great, but let's not forget he was a complete liability at cornerback for the Titans.
Oh my God, he was. Oh yes.
Ah, all right.
This is one of my favorites to play.
Yeah?
Because, I mean, for beginners, this is more challenging than just a typical G-C-D affair.
Yeah.
But at the same time, it's not Neon. You know what I mean? It's still attainable to play this song.
It doesn't require flexible fingers. Like, you just need to be able to play basic chords. Well, not basic.
And then it's got that My Stupid Mouth Melt type of rhythm. God, I love this song. I did have a cover of this up on my YouTube channel, my personal one, and I just took it down because I was like, you know what, I'm just going to use that for original music.
Yeah.
And also, that's not the mayor song I want to settle on covering, you know what
but
I mean?
But you just covered that recently, though.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah, that was a good one.
Oh, thanks. I removed it already.
I watched it. Well, shit.
I love the lyrics in this. I don't know, I can't remember if this one is a co-written run with Clay Cook, or if Inside Watts Out is entirely co-written with him. But the lyrics are just so goddamn good in this.
Yeah.
I'm calling it Love Soon, like, it just didn't resonate with me at all when I was a dumb kid learning this song.
Yeah.
And then you go back and, like, listen to it, now, and you're like, it's good. Yeah. It's kind of like, you know what? It's kind of like trying to define a relationship, which he's written about before.
Yeah.
Trying to define a relationship and just basically putting your foot down and going, tough shit. We are what we are.
Right.
You know what I mean? This is love, and you're going to deny it all you want.
God damn it.
Yeah. I love that. And he says it himself. Let's my past the bullshit.
Yeah.
I love that chord, by the way.
Yeah.
And move on because it moves faster. Because there's not enough time in the world. You gotta... Man, this is a great song to dissect,
it's
man.
It's an amazing song. So, good way to end it.
And I wish he played it more. I'd love to hear a full band. How does it sound full band? Does it sound shitty? Like, oh, it's just Love Soon with band. Like, it's not anything special.
I don't think it would sound right live without it being one man acoustic.
Especially because that's all we know. Yeah. Like that and Victoria, I just can't hear with a band or quiet.
Dude. Victoria's actually like one of the most sentimental songs ever.
Yeah. Ever. And he's just like, oh, I just wrote about a girl in the dorm. I'm like, see, I hate you. I hate you.
That's one
the
thing.
Things that inspire you inspire that beautiful stuff. And the things that inspire me, I'm just like, I'm just going to write a GCD chord.
Yeah.
A song or whatever.
Yeah.
Victoria left the dorm room the other day. Like,
was it during the Storytellers where he was like, I might write a song about a 1 second long feeling?
Yeah.
Was that when he said that? And I thought that was really poignant because I've never had the ability to do that. To take something so microscopic and turn it into a scenario.
Yeah.
A story.
Yeah.
You know, like,
suddenly,
I've always been really good at experiencing things
right.
and telling a smaller story with relation to a bigger thing that really happened. Narrowing it down and getting to the juice, but never like, oh my God, I spilled water on the table.
This is suddenly a thing.
This is suddenly a thing. and then you turn it into a whole song. You know?
Right.
I mean, not like anything innocuous like that would ever get written by John Mayer. But.
Right. Well, he did write a song, an unreleased song called Taking on Water. So, I mean, you never know. That could have been a result of a spill.
And if he did it at a door? Holy shit. Two songs covered with one drink spill. I'm never going to let that one go. That's such a good reason to not like that song. Oh, shit.
Come at us. All right, so... That's your favorite song. I think we can go on record
and
acknowledge that War of My Life is JD's favorite song 100%. To ever be written by anybody.
Love
ever.
War. I love war. It's huge.
It's huge. It's great.
It's the best war.
It's the best war. You know the best war is Persian.
Well,
Persia. Persian Gulf.
Big fan of 300. They're some of my favorite. I've met all of them.
I met them all.
They're great.
You know, they're still doing great work out there. These guys are doing phenomenal. Leonidas, great guy.
I thought it was Leonardo.
Leonardo.
That's a turtle.
We could keep going on this for fucking ever. We could be a whole podcast. Leonidas, great guy.
Huge.
Great. You know, they asked to remove his statue, and I said, no, they're not going to do that.
He kicked the black guy down a hole.
Oh, my God.
Huge.
Huge.
He said, no, we don't stand for immigrants here. No, it's a hole. It's
and
not
said,
a wall.
He said, look, this is America. Okay? Look. This is America.
And then he kicked in with his Doc Martens, which are, everybody knows, all American made.
American made.
All American made British shoes.
You know what? But I love Crocs.
I love Crocs.
Sue me,
Crocs
but don't sue me. I love
look,
Crocs.
They're comfortable, but. So comfortable! Hey,
hey!
Here we go!
Hey, they're.
Ah, Crocs were. Dude, I can't even get it out. This is ridiculous.
This is far more.
For the three people that make it to the end of this episode, you are so fucking welcome right now.
Yeah, I know. This is far more intelligent than our poop song, that's for sure.
Well, yeah, I'm giving you full writing credits on that one. I inspired it slightly. Maybe a poop inspired it of yours that you were thinking of specifically. Well, awesome. This was very, very good, sir. Very good, sir.
Yeah, this was fun. So, a message in a podcast.
Was that a title we were throwing around at first? Because
no.
That is that's a really good one. Message in a podcast?
No, it's not.
I know, but not for an original John Mayer podcast.
I guess I should end it because now I'm just bullshitting. Anyway, stay tuned for next week when we're probably going to have I'm going to try and get James on. He doesn't know it yet. We're going to try and get James on to talk about Continuum more from like a songwriter perspective and what the album, why it's in his top three.
Yeah.
Because why, Georgia? So check us out on iTunes and we're on the Google Play. We're
everywhere.
On Stitcher. We're on TuneIn. We're everywhere. I'm at Jeff Witty, WIDDY on Twitter. We're on Facebook, of course. We're in that Facebook group, John Mayer Knows Best. And if you like John Mayer and you think he knows best, you should definitely be in that group.
Great group. Like 5,000 people, like we said, active, nice community. Mm-hmm. There's like no...
You just inflated those numbers.
Oh my God.
4,000.
Okay, sorry. There's 1.5 million people in the group, guys.
Yeah.
They were all there.
The press refuses to acknowledge it.
Don't listen to these alternative news stories. Fake news.
Sorry, it's just too fun.
It's a great group, though, so and a lot of good conversation comes out of it, so I look forward to being active there, because I have no other social media presence at all.
Yeah, me neither. Well, I mean, except for Twitter, I guess, and Instagram. So I guess I just cheated and lied to everybody. It's kind of like that song, The Hurt. Doesn't he talk about lying and cheating and stealing in that song?
Yeah.
Whatever, that's a good song. I wish he didn't do away with it or blend it into Friends, Lovers, or Nothing.
Yeah.
It's a good song. So thanks for listening again, and we'll be back soon.
Yeah.
With one of our last episodes. I guess I should tell everybody now, we're probably gonna format this like a season.
Yeah.
Cause I just don't think I could keep going every single week with shit.
No, take a break and recoup, because we got big shit coming in April.
Yeah, exactly.
So, I mean, that's gonna be some preparation there.
Schedule a return around then, or just do an intermittent episode about his new stuff.
Yeah, as the waves release too. Yeah. You know, I'm free to talk about that. Yeah. So we might have to do that. But
April, we're going to Kansas City.
God, I'm so excited, dude.
Oh, I'm so pumped.
Fucking excited for that.
I'm so pumped, man.
Yeah.
I normally despise road trips, only because the last one I went on alone and I got pulled over twice. It was bullshit.
Yeah.
It wasn't my fault. It was because I was white.
Those police should just really check
it's
their
It's just
privilege.
Troopers, man. Fucking troopers, man. They'll pull over anybody. They don't give a shit. If you're going over, you're going over, and you're going to get pulled over.
Yep.
So I had a ticket then.
Good times.
FYI, that's who you're going to get in the car with, is a guy who just got off of a ticket.
Click it or ticket, man.
Yeah, I know, right?
It's okay. I'm going to have a lot of weed in the car. No, I won't. I'm just kidding.
Yeah, there's going to be a cop listening to this podcast.
Oh, shit.
We need to... I'm going to radio in some...
since here on February,
aerial assistance to keep an eye to follow this truck.
Apparently he brought UV lights and he's cooking in the trunk. He's cooking weed.
Because you cook it. You put it in a microwave, clearly.
He's so
you put
baked,
a plant
cooking
in it.
My weed.
Yeah. That's why I call it baked, because you just literally you put it in an oven. And that's,
dude, yeah.
Boom, weed comes out.
It's going to be fun. Do you think we can listen to the entire John Mayer non-live catalog on the road trip? Is that
probably
under
twice.
8 hours? Yeah.
8 hours? Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Oh, you're talking about all his LPs?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Just recorded stuff.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, Inside Coheed, including Coheed Inside Wants Out. Yeah.
Coheed for
and
the
then
rest.
And then we'll have to be like, okay, maybe we should listen to live stuff. Yeah, we'll probably run out.
Coheed.
I don't like Coheed.
I'm going to get you there.
Oh, God damn it. You say yeah. So you should...
Dude, you're a comic book fan. I can get you.
You'll definitely, I think, take over the radio whenever you're driving. Because that's the, you know, isn't that the cardinal rule? Whoever's driving controls the radio.
Am I driving?
Yeah, we're both driving. Why would I drive the whole thing?
Asshole, you never said anything about... No, I'm kidding.
I thought you were serious.
Just drive the whole 8 hours by yourself, you fucking idiot. God. Dude, of course I'm driving.
I thought you were... That was so sincere. Oh, man, our trip was fucked.
God.
So stay tuned for more Bigger Than My Purd Cursed. And we will be around on Facebook if you want to hit us up.
Yep.
We are open to communicating, and we love when you guys communicate with us.
Just
drop us comments and stuff. On YouTube, for example, there's one, the Room for Squares episode, where I was talking with somebody. I don't remember who I was talking to. I don't remember which episode it was, but we name-dropped the St. Patrick's Day version that he did in 2005-ish, where he finger-picked.
Is that the one with Gabe?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
It might have been.
Because it sounds familiar.
And this dude dropped a comment and was like, here you go, here's the link to that. Here's the link to that version of St. Patrick's Day. And I was like, yes, thank you.
Thank you.
That's
what
I want people to do. Like, whenever we're lost, just
that's
post
awesome.
Something about
it's
it.
It's still so amazing to me that, like, people are actually listening to this and digesting it. And
yeah.
There was a genuine
they're listening
need
intently.
For
yeah.
it. Yeah. Because I feel like a lot of people shit on Mayer.
Right.
They're outside of the Mayer.
Yeah, they're just kind of like, your body's Warnerland, stupid.
Yeah. And you know what? You're not wrong. But fucking listen to more.
Yeah, listen to more. Yeah.
Listen to more. So... It's awesome, dude. This whole thing is just great.
Yeah, it's been a friggin' blast. We're internet famous now. No, I'm kidding.
Ish. Hey, people
we have 20 listeners. We're good.
Know us.
Yeah.
People in Europe know us.
Oh my God, they do. That's right.
Yeah.
I got that the dude in Ireland still messaging me on Facebook. It's a good dude. Good cat.
The person that plugged us on, I'm sorry, I can't remember your name right now. Was it Claire?
I can't remember.
Plugged us on the page?
On the podcast, the group, the mayor group.
Yep.
I can't remember her name either. I'm sorry. I'm sorry for blanking on her name, but you really put our name out there.
Which was awesome.
Yeah, that was really great.
That was really cool to see.
Yeah, we love it. We love the sense of community.
Claudine,
that's right. We love the sense of community, though. Even if you have like negative criticisms or whatever, give a shit. That's fine.
Yeah, talk shit all you want, because we would probably do the same about you, but like with love.
Yeah. But at the same time, if there's something that I need to add to the show, that would be great.
Yeah.
That I'm like, oh, damn, that's a good idea. I should probably get on that. Anyway. So, peace out, guys.
I'll be a